Okay, so I'm starting. So this is my class three. For information, I am going to tell you that what are the topics which I have covered. The first one I have covered is the block schematic of measuring system, the performance characteristic, static characteristics, accuracy, precision, resolution, type of error, Gaussian error, root sum, square formula, dynamic characteristics, repeatability, reproducibility, fidelity, lag. So this is the part one of unit one, what I have covered. So we have solved some of the problem, as I have already said, that this subject is related to your theory part, your derivation part, and the problematic part. So wherever you are having a theory, then to that one is a derivation. Based on the derivation, the formula, you have given a small problem that has to be solved. So please keep your calculator ready for solving the problems and keep your formula ready to solve it. So in this today's class, I am going to start the part B of unit one, that is nothing but the measuring instruments. So measuring instruments we are practically been using in our labs. So the measuring instruments are nothing but the DC voltmeter, DC current meter, AC voltmeter, current meter, ohm meters, multimeters. So these are the different instruments which we'll be using in our day-to-day life when we are working on a practical one. So in this one, we are going to see the basic principle on which these are going to work. Then afterwards, we are going to see the meter protection. Then the extension of the ranges. Extension of the range is very important in order to get the accuracy, which we have covered in a part one. Then we are going to see the true RMS, responding voltmeter, and the specification of the instruments. So I'm starting my class from this particular point. So first one is the suspension galvanometer. And the galvanometer is used for DC measurements. This is very important bit, and this bit has come in many of the competitive examinations. So suspension galvanometer is used for a DC measurement, and it is one of the earliest measuring instrument mechanism. So here you can see a coil of fine line. I'm going to show you the pic here. So from this pic, you can see that a coil of fine wire is suspended in the magnetic field, and it is produced by the permanent magnet. So here you are having the horseshoe magnet. This is the pointer. This is the zero position control. This is used to reset the position to bring it back to the zero position. These are the control spring which are holding these pointers. Then we are going to have a counterweight. This is the pole shoe and this is the coil. So I'm explaining you the general principle of this particular thing. So a coil, a fine wire is suspended in a magnetic field produced by a permanent magnet. When electric current is passed through the coil will rotate in the magnetic field, and this fine filament consists of coil served to carry the current. The electricity of the filament set up by the moderate torque is opposition to the rotation of the coil. So the deflection of the torque is given by, so the deflection of the torque is the electromagnetic torque. The balancing torque is the mechanical counter torque of the suspension. And the coil will deflect until these two torques becomes the equal. So the pointer is attached to the coil, which is indicative of the corresponding media, and the coil deflection is the measure of the current carried by it. So apart from this one, an optical effect is also used by attaching a mirror to the coil, which deflects a beam of light. So the principle governing the suspension galvanometer applies to the permanent magnetic moving coil mechanism. So it is also said to be the PMMC, that is the permanent magnet moving coil. And here we are having an expression. When current flows in the coil, an EM torque is developed and causes the coils to rotate. The EM torque is balanced by the mechanical torque or control springs attached to the moving coil, and hence the expression of the torque is given by T is equal to capital B A I N. So where T is the torque produced, the units are the newtons per meter, B is the flux density in the air gap. So here we are going to get an air gap which will be creating. For that one, we are going to take it in the measures of the Tesla or the Weber units by meter square, where A is the effective coil area, which is measured in the meter square, and A is the LVR. Please note that these are the L is the capital, this is the W. Sorry, A is equal to L small w, where L is the length of the coil and W is the width of the coil. Capital I is the current in the movable coil and N is the number of turns on the coil. So this is the coil, and to this one we are going to have the turns. So this is going to measure. So this is the basic principle of your PMMC, which is also said to be the permanent magnet moving coil. And this, the expression of torque is given by T is equal to B A I N. So this torque, from this one you can directly see that the torque is directly proportional to flux density, effective coil area, current in the movable coil, and the number of wires in a coil. So this is directly proportional, and the flux density of the coil area are fixed for a given instrument. And the typical value of the coil A will be in the A range of 0.5 to 2.5 centimeters, and whereas the B, flux density in the air gap, will be ranging from 1500 to 5000 gauss or 0.15 to 0.5 tesla. So the next topic is the d'Arsenal movement. This is the oldest method and it was invented by d'Arsenal. So that is the reason it is said to be the d'Arsenal movement. So the PMC movement was invented by the d'Arsenal, and hence it is called as d'Arsenal movement. The power consumption in this system is very low and it requires the current for free scale deflection, so which is nothing but the FSD. This system has a permanent magnet in the horseshoe. I'll just show you the figure and I'll explain you. So this is the figure system, and it has a permanent magnet in the horseshoe from which the soft pole pieces attached to it. Between the pole pieces is a cylinder of soft iron. It provides uniform magnetic field in the air gap between the pole pieces and the cylinder. The coil is wound on a light metal frame and is mounted so that it can rotate freely in the air gap. The pointer attached to this coil moves over the graduated scale, which indicates the angular deflection of the coil and therefore the current through the coil. Thus, the deflection torque TD is produced by the EM effect. The controlling torque TC is provided by two phosphorus bronze conductive springs. So here the spring tension must be uniform for maintaining the accuracy of the instrument. The moving system is balanced by the three wheels. The V jewel, so the next figure is this one, PMMC two type, the V jewel bearing and the spring back jewel bearing. So this V jewel is commonly used in instrument bearing. The top of the pilot may have a radius of 0.01 to 0.02 mm. So the basic BMC instrument is a linear reading DC instrument, because TD, that that is the torque, is directly proportional to the coil current. So we can see that this is the range in which it is going to work. So the next one is the power requirements. The power requirements of the deorsonal moment will be in the range of 25 to 200 microwatts. The accuracy of the instrument is of the order of 2 to 5% of full scale reading. The PMC instrument is unsuitable for the AC measurement. This is a very, very important point which you have to remember. This question has been asked in many of the competitive examination. It is unsuitable for AC measurement unless the current is rectified before the application of the coil. So in this figure, it shows the details of moving coil of PMC movement. So this is the PMC movement, and this is the figure which shows the details of instrument bearing, and we are going to have the calculations. So let us have one problem on exercise. Let us have an exercise on moving coil instrument. So I am taking one simple problem where we have seen one formula which is directly proportional. So the problem says that a moving coil instrument has the following data. Number of turns is 100, width of the coil is 20 mm, depth of the coil is 30 mm, flux density in the air is 0.1 webnors per meter square. So now we have to calculate the deflection torque when carrying a current of 10 milliamps, and we have to also calculate the deflection if the control spring constant is 2 into 10 to the power of minus 6 mn newtons meter per degree. So we know the formula. So the deflection torque is given by BANI. So whatever the values from the given data, you have to calculate all these things and you have to execute it. So by doing this one, we are going to get the PD as 60 into 10 to power of minus 6 newtons per meter. Then we have to calculate the spring control providing a restoring torque. So which is given by tau C is equal to K theta, where capital K is the spring constant, and as the deflection torque is equal to the resonating torque, we are going to evaluate this one. Therefore, TC we are going to get KQ. From this one, we are going to calculate the value of the deflection. So by doing this one, we are going to get the deflection of 30 degrees. So this is a direct formula which you have to apply. So this is another problem. In this one, the data is same what I have taken earlier. A moving coil instrument has the following data. The number of turns given as 100, width of the coil is given as 20 mm, depth of the coil is given as 30 mm, flux density in the air gap is given as 0.1 webnor per meter square. So calculate the current through the moving coil. So here also we are making use of the direct formula which we have studied. That is, the deflection torque is given by tau D is equal to BAN into I. So please calculate from the above one and take the data. By doing this one, we are going to calculate the I, which is nothing but the current through the moving coil. I, we are going to get the 5 milliamps. Right? Okay. So the next one is the meter protection. So next topic is the meter protection. So the meter protection, the DC meter are usually protected by connecting a diode across the meter. So you can see this is the diode D1, which is connected across the meter. This is the single diode protection, and B is going to give you the double diode protection where this is the meter and it is connected to the anode and to the another cathode point of the D2, and the other end are connected in this. So the DC protection is the DC meter are usually protected connecting a diode across the meter. If a silicon diode is used, the voltage drop across the meter is maintained. At 0.6 volts are just below the cut-in voltage V nu of the diode. When the input exceeds the maximum value, the diode start conducting and its cut-in voltage value is reached due to the excess input. Therefore, the current is divided or diverted through the diode protecting the meter. If only one diode is used, it is called a single diode protection. If two diodes are used for both half cycles or either direction, it is called double diode protection as shown in the figure. So next we are going to see, so these are the what I have explained you. At 0.6 volt, just below the cut-in voltage, the diode is going to conduct and we are going to get this. The next one is the extension of range. So what is this extension of the range? The range of measuring instrument can be extended suitably by connecting a resistance in series. I'm showing you the picture. Connected in series or a shunt as the case may be. If the range of the ammeter is to be extended, a shunt resistance of a value lower than the meter resistance is connected in parallel with the meter as shown in the figure. So you can see from this figure, I'm repeating this point once again. So in this figure, you can see there is one meter. To that meter, we have connected a resistance R in series and another resistance RS connected in the shunt. So here you can see the current is coming here. It is getting divided into IM and IS, and finally it is going to become as an I. So this I is nothing but the total current to be measured, and IS is the current through the shunt resistor, and this IM is the maximum current that can be permitted through the meter, and R is the resistance of the meter, and RS is the shunt resistance. So by using the knowledge of our previous one, the network analysis, so here I can say current I is nothing but the IM plus IS. So by using this formula, I is equal to IM plus IS. So IM is the I minus IS. So IS is equal to I minus IM. Therefore, IS RS is equal to IM into R. By using this one, I am going to calculate the RS value as IM R by IS. That is nothing but replacing the IS value with I minus IM. So finally, I am going to get RS is equal to IM R by I minus IM. So now I am going to divide upper side and lower side with the IM. So by doing this one, I am going to calculate my RS value. That is nothing but R is equal to R divided by 1 by IM minus 1. So this is how we are going to calculate. So the ratio of the total current to the instrument current I by IM is called the multiplying power of the shunt. This is usually expressed as N. Hence, We can also represent the term as Rs is equal to R by n minus 1 or n is equal to 1 plus R by Rs. So the shunt are available commercially. So they consist of one or more thin strips of manganese, the end of which are soldered for two heavy copper blocks. So similarly, we can see that a special pair of the leads are usually supplied with the ammeter intended to use, and the manganese has a low temperature coefficient, therefore it will not get heated up. The shunt will have a good heat radiation ability. Now coming to the extending the range of the voltmeter. So extending the range of the voltmeter, the range of voltmeter can be extended in a similar way by connecting a high resistance in series with the meter so that only the permissible maximum current passes through the meter. So this is the ammeter. Here we are seeing the RM. Here we are going to see the RS. So this is the IM current, and this VM is the voltage across the meter, and V is the total voltage. So where IM is the maximum current that can pass through the meter, VM is the maximum voltage range of the meter, RM is the meter resistance, RS is the series resistance to be connected to extend the range of the meter, and V is the extended volt range. So similarly, by calculating the value, we know that V is equal to IM RS minus IM RM. So by using this formula, we are going to calculate the RS. So it is very simple. We have to calculate the value of RS using the formula which we have derived from this particular equations. So I am repeating this one. V is equal to IM RS minus IM RM. When we are going to solve, we are going to get the RS value as, we are going to get RS value as V by IM plus RM. Thus, the value of RS to be connected in series with the meter to extend its voltage range from VM to V can be calculated. So now we are going to see the AC voltmeter with the rectifiers. So I hope you have remembered the rectifier circuit. So what is a rectifier? Rectifier is one which is going to convert your AC to DC one. So AC voltmeter using the rectifier, if a diode D1 is active, I'll show you the figure, okay. If the diode D1 is added to DC voltmeter as shown in the figure, we have an AC voltmeter using the half-wave rectifier circuit capable of measuring the AC voltages, and the sensitivity of the DC meter is given by SDC is equal to, so here I have done the calculation also. So these are the waveforms. So I'll just read out the values which we have already worked out in the rectifier section at the SDC. The sensitivity is given by 1 by 1 FST, that is 1 by 1 milliamp, which is going to get the 1 kilo ohm. So like this, we have to have a multiples of 10 times this value, means a 10 volts DC input, which will cause the exactly full scale deflection when connected with the proper prior polarities. So let us assume D to be an ideal diode with negligible forward bias resistance. If this DC input is replaced by 10 volts RMS sine wave input, then the voltage appearing to the output is due to the half wave cycle of this rectifying section. So therefore, I can tell the peak value of 10 volts RMS sine wave can be E peak is equal to 10 volts RMS into 1.414, that is 14.14 volts peak. So similarly, the DC will respond to the average value of AC input. Therefore, I can say E average is equal to EP into 0.636, that is 14.14 into 0.636, that is 8.99 volts. Since the diode conducts only during the positive half cycle, because here we are having the positive, negative, only during the positive half cycle, the average value over the entire cycle is one half the average value of 0.99 volts. That is about 4.5 volts. Therefore, the pointer will deflect for a full scale if 10 volts DC is applied and 4.5 volts when a 10 BRMS sinusoidal signal is applied. This means that an AC voltmeter is not as sensitive as a DC voltmeter. So here we are having the values. So for the negative half cycle of the input supply D1, it will get the reverse bias and it will not conduct, and thus only the half cycle, half wave rectification of the input supply is given in this way. This is the output of the half wave rectifier. The average value of the applied input signal is given by this equation. And these are some of the equation which I have solved. Okay, I was just seeing the time which is left over. It seems to be only 2-3 minutes time is left over. So in this class, I will be covering up to the AC voltmeter using the half wave rectifier only. So in the next class, we will continue it using the AC voltmeter using the full wave rectifier. So this is the equation which we have solved it, because this equation are not available in your textbook. So kindly go through this equation, and in problem also, you have to take the V average value. Then you have to calculate using the formula which we did in our earlier classes. Then we have to calculate the V average value for half wave and the full wave. So I'm stopping this class up to here, and I'm just going to revise what I have said in this class today. So the first thing is, I have started the class with the topic which I have covered in the previous one, that is the part A of the unit 1, that is the block schematic of measuring systems. Then today we have started with the measuring instrument, where we have seen the basic fundamental concepts, and in this class I have explained you the suspension galvanometer, the D-arsenal moment, the meter protection, and the extension of the range, that is extension of the ammeter and the voltmeter. So we could see it only for the half wave rectifier. Thank you so much for attending this class. I'll try my level best to take the classes regularly once the college is open. When the class will be face to face, I will be once again explaining you this concept. So before closing, I would like to tell you, this subject is one in which where you get more number of bits in your competition examinations, and all these small formulas are there. Based on that one, you are going to get the problems. So please try to solve the problem and go through the pictures, the figures very properly, because a small change in the placement of resistance, instead of keeping a series resistance, if you keep a shunt resistance, the basic fundamental concept will change. So hence I request you to draw your circuit very correctly. See that where exactly series resistance has to place, where exactly the shunt resistance has to place, how we have to use the meters and its ranges. So thank you so much. I'm stopping the class up to here. In case of any doubt, you can put up the questions in the WhatsApp group, or you can send to my WhatsApp group personally. Thank you. 1 minute, I'll take the attendance of all of you. Okay. So today total 14 participants have attended.